That's not a comic book. Now that's a comic book.
Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of Comic Reviews. I'm Sid Part 2, and we have a fairly good size stack of comics today, including two trades. So, I haven't done two trades in a while, and one of them is really short, so I figured I'd do two this week. Anyway, let's go ahead and get started right away with the last thing I read today, which is Vader Down, number one of one. I thought it was kind of interesting because they have like the checklist here in the last page, and Vader Down is the only item on the checklist that is Vader Down. Everything else is their normal books, so I guess they just got to do a special issue for the beginning of this big crossover event. That's not even that big a crossover, it's just Darth Vader story affecting the main Star Wars book, and from what I understand, none of the other books. Whatever works, I guess. I thought that was kind of interesting. That being said, this is really good. I mean, it just starts out really strong. It's Darth Vader having, you know, a very intimidating conversation with Dr. Aphra, who's the chick he's been working with. I finally learned her name. Having a very intimidating conversation, as you do with Darth Vader. And then he goes, I'm dropping out of warp now. And it's just a ton of X-Wings right in front of him as he drops out of warp. And it's like, holy shit. So you immediately turn the page to figure out what's happening next. And you get the title. I thought that was a really cool, like, it's very cinematic. Or not even cinematic, it's almost like TV. You'll have that. Kind of like, I know people have very mixed feelings about the show Arrow, but one thing I thought that show did incredibly well was where it placed its title sequence and stuff. Because, I mean, that just, that felt really awesome. That show always had very good cliffhangers and intros into the title and like where that was going to happen at. And I always found that very well timed on that show. And like this, that moment right there just really did it for me. But so what the premise of this is Darth Vader is going to try to find Luke. And of course, Luke is with the Rebellion. So unexpectedly, Darth Vader walks into the middle of a rebel space drills, basically. And he takes out, like, two wings of X-Wing fighters on his own, but Luke's up there with him, and Luke crashes his X-Wing into Darth Vader's TIE fighter, and they go down and land on the planet together. And so, like, the entire rebel fleet is basically mobilizing all to go after Darth Vader, or at least entire wing, or not wings, battalions are mobilizing on this planet just to go after Darth Vader. And so, like, they're all going up overnight, and Han and Leia and everyone is headed to the planet to go after him too, and Darth Vader's just on a mission to find Luke, and Luke's crashed too, so he's on a mission to join back up with the rebels and go after Vader with him. And there's just this really cool cliffhanger moment where Vader's walking through the desert, you know, alone. And then suddenly he's ambushed by just a shit ton of rebels. And they go, Darth Vader, lay down your weapons. You're surrounded. And you just see him in the middle of this gigantic ambush. Just hundreds of soldiers, possibly thousands of soldiers. And he goes, all I am surrounded by is fear and dead men. And then the lightsaber kicks on. That's the end of the issue. Really strong issue. I just think it's kind of funny that they started a book, that they did it just in one book. That it wasn't just part of the normal Darth Vader book or whatever. I guess, I don't know. I don't know how it works. Excuse me. Computers being stupid. Anyway. I don't know exactly what the whole legal thing is, or if they only had a certain number of issues to split up between, whatever. It's kind of just silly that it's all in one book, but it is a really good opening issue for this. I decided to read this last since it ties into something I talked about last week, so I thought it'd be fun to talk about in relation to that. So you can go ahead and click. There'll be a link in the description after all the timestamps for last week's episode where I talked about the Darth Vader book. And I really wasn't even in love with that book last week or anything. It was probably the best thing I read last week. But overall, it was just a fairly average issue with kind of an iffy cliffhanger payoff. But this makes up for it. I wish I'd read this last week. This is so cool. They really did, you know, market the shit out of that really well. That you know, to be continued in Darth Vader Down number one, and then to get the checklist in the back. It really made me want to go pick this up. And if you picked it up, it's definitely worth reading. Or if you didn't pick it up, go back to the store, buy Darth Vader 12 and Darth Vader Down number one. Or I guess you don't even have to buy Darth Vader number 12. I guess you could just get this. Because, like, that ties into this, but not in a major way. And you would kind of just be a little lost. Yeah, I guess go ahead and just get this. It's pretty basic. Darth Vader's looking, like, you have the opening crawl. Speaking of which, better this week than the last Darth Vader book. This is just, it just reads a lot better. It feels more Star Wars-ish. Not quite as good as I thought it started out, but still not bad. Yeah, really, really cool stuff. I don't know what else to say. It's just really fun, really, really well timed, though. That's the thing that really gets me, just that I almost could feel some of the sound effects and the music cues and everything. Just a really cool action book. Like, it's really thick, but it reads pretty quick because a lot of it is action, but that's a good thing because it's really engaging, really edge of your seat, like, oh my god, I gotta get to the next page kind of action. And it looks stunning. The explosions and the lasers and lasers, guys, look at that. That's awesome. Just a million X-Wings. Well, not a million. Just a bunch of X-Wings shooting at Darth Vader's TIE fighter. That's really cool. I also like Vader as a pilot again. Because we really set that up in the prequels. They make a big deal about how good a pilot Anakin is. And then you kind of get the sense that Darth Vader was actually a good pilot in episode 4. But then it doesn't really... Yeah, it doesn't really come up again. It's not really a big thing that he's a pilot. He's not really in the trenches, quote-unquote, in any of the other Star Wars movies besides episode 4. And so it's just cool to see Darth Vader kind of blended with some of the points I liked about the Clone Wars cartoon more. And some of the interesting stuff in the prequels, I guess. But yeah, really, really strong issue to open up this story arc. And so I'll be picking up the whole story arc. I guess part 2 is Darth Vader number 13. So that won't be out for another month or so. I'd assume they wouldn't put it out for about another month. But, you know, maybe could have waited another week for this. So that way it would feel possibly like you're getting an issue every 2 weeks. That might have been a good idea. Anyway, really fun book though. Now we just need the Star Wars Marvel Universe crossover. Let's go ahead and go on, sticking with the space theme, to Star Trek Green Lantern The Spectrum War number 5 of 6. It's taken a while, but we're finally getting to a lot more meat in this story. Okay. So I'm disappointed that the Enterprise, the Green Lantern Construct Enterprise, doesn't really do much. It just kind of protects the Enterprise. I was really hoping to see Hal, like, properly pilot the Enterprise, working all the controls by himself, or via constructs, and just do a really cool, you know, proper Star Trek-style battle in the middle of just this this shitstorm that we open up with here. I mean, look at that. It's just an explosion of colors. So I was disappointed that that didn't quite happen. We got a little bit, you know, I mean, it's a, certainly a cool splash page, but I was really hoping for something more, substantial, I guess. Like I said, this seems like it'd be better if it were more issues. Really feels like they're pushing getting this down to six. This would have been a good, I'd say 8 issues would have probably been good for this, because 6, just, it's starting to feel really quick, like they're setting stuff up that they don't have time to pay off, is what it comes down to. But anyway, so Uhura goes and resurrects the crew after they were, you know, neutralized by Sinestro. Kilowog, Guy Gardner, and John Stewart show up, which is kind of surprising. I really thought it was just going to be one Lantern per core and then one member of the GL, or one member of the Trekverse getting a ring as well. Still haven't given anyone a green ring, so I'm waiting for that to go to Kirk. I mean, that's, it's going to be cool, but it's still really obvious. I mean, you know, you can't escape that as long as you've been waiting for this. My guess is Hal's going to be killed, Ring's going to go to Kirk. Hal, or maybe one of these other Green Lanterns that they just had show up. Hopefully it's not John Stewart, because I'd really like it to be Guy Gardner. If Guy Gardner got to die so that Captain Kirk could get a Green Lantern ring, this would be a just universe that we live in. I highly doubt it'll happen. John will probably get the short end of the stick. Or Kilowog. I guess he is the most out of place. Let's see here. So they kind of like take a tactful retreat and end up heading toward Vulcan. Sinestro surrenders himself because he's convinced that they cannot defeat Necron without him. Necron, of course, is resurrected Vulcan. And Scotty makes a frickin' ring. I like the example that he uses as he talks about it. It's by no means an exact replica. There's technology in those rings that makes me feel like a caveman poking at a warp core. I've still no idea how they create objects out of pure energy, but I think we've created the equivalent of a phaser one can wear on one finger, or you can wear on one finger. And so Sulu gets, you know, a Trek ring, I guess we'll call it. I mean, I'm suspicious of the fact that it's white. And if you look... Oh, come on, camera. Okay, that's probably the best I'm going to be able to get it for you. If you look there, that does vaguely look like it might be the White Lantern symbol. I'm not sure how well-versed the writer of this series is in Johnson. Who's writing? Mike Johnson. Not sure how well versed they are in Green Lantern lore. Writer or artist, because that could be the artist coming up with that too. But you do see that a lot in a lot of the Green Lantern books where like the symbol will be part of the construct or energy escaping from around the person. So that does vaguely resemble the White Lantern symbol, so maybe Sulu will be the White Lantern that they'll need to take on Necron. Gardner's, of course, being annoying. So anyway, they land on Vulcan, and this is a pretty cool moment. Spock's using the tricorder and goes, "I'm not detecting any signs of life, Captain." And then Necron's voice, "And why would you? For in this place you will only find the one great constant found in every universe. Death." And then a bunch of Vulcans behind him. And that's the conclusion of the issue. So, once again, I don't feel like there's been enough time. Really, really would have loved, you know, 8 issues, maybe even up to 10. That being said, that might be a little unrealistic for, you know, almost a full year to finish out one little mini series. That being said, though, I've never lost interest with this. I've just felt like there isn't enough detail and there's missed opportunities. Like I said, the Orange Ring, they gave it to a Romulan. It would have been a really cool chance, since we're in a different timeline, to have that be the reason that Starfleet knows about the Ferengi. You know, so early on, since they aren't introduced properly until Next Generation in the original timeline. That being said, though, it's still really fun to read. I guess I would be enjoying this more if it were one volume, though I still think I'd have problems with it. But if I were reading this all in one go, I'd probably be enjoying it slightly more than I am now. But it is insanely fun. And that's what you want with a crossover like this. You just want it to be enjoyable and cool and get to sink your teeth into it and just, you know, just to put a smile on your face. And it's certainly doing that. Like I said, I just feel like there are missed opportunities that they could have explored in greater depth. So yeah, there's not a lot of story to it. I just explained the whole plot. I like that Scotty developed a ring. That's really cool. Scotty is by far my favorite engineer. I guess just a quick list. Scotty, Geordi, Rom, all of Scotty's staff, all of Geordi's staff, including Reggie, the dude in the holosuites, literally every other officer in Starfleet that has ever done anything with engineering or even taken an exam, O'Brien. That's pretty much how it is. Just imagine that was all one big list of people. And then O'Brien at the very, very end. And then O'Brien's wife. So yeah, that's my feelings on Star Trek engineering crew. But yeah, Scotty's just really cool, and I really like the Abramsverse version of him too. He's really, you know, Simon Pegg, is that his name? Yeah, I think so. He does a really fun performance of it and everything, and Scotty is probably my favorite character in the original series, so just getting to see him invent a Green Lantern ring, or, you know, kind of an offshoot of it is pretty cool. And Guy Gardner's got to be a smartass and be like, oh, it's still not a real ring. I'm like, you know, motherfucker just invented this thing that you take for granted that was created by a race of immortals billions of years into their history before they were able to invent it. This guy got one look at it and was like, okay, I think I got this. Here's the junior version of it, and he's created it. And like I said, it's suspiciously white. So I'm questioning the White Lantern-ness of it. But yeah, fun book. Certainly a fun book. It's very enjoyable. Not in love with the cover this month. Just finding things to talk about, I guess. Anyway, that'll do it for that issue, so let's go ahead and move on. Captain America, Sam Wilson, Captain America number 3, Cap Wolf, is back. And this cover just looks so 70s, blaxploitationist, and I love it. It's weird that this issue came out in November. It really seems like an October thing. Cap Wolf. I think they might have been a little behind on that one. Anyway, I'm still loving the introduction page on this. I really love the idea of Twitter to explain how everything's, or what all's going on. Twitter and news feeds kind of combined, and then even the writing credits are on a, you know, iPhone or whatever. So, what's her name? Misty, yeah. So Misty breaks into this warehouse that Sam Wilson went missing in, and fights some kind of boar, and then discovers that Cap has been turned into a werewolf. And she's like just taking the opportunity to make a bunch of jokes. And the reason this happened is because Sam broke in on a doctor. What's his name? Carl Malice. Dr. Malice, really. This is very comic booky. I mean, I suppose he did just turn a man into a giant iguana. So, you know, I don't have much room to complain. Still, Dr. Malice. So Cap breaks in on him and roughs him up, but then we find out that he was merged with the Carnage symbiote at one point and so has properties from that, and is able to subdue Cap, and that's how he turned him into a werewolf, and then kind of just left him in the warehouse before he tried to move shop. Cap breaks in on him moving shop because of a thing with Falcon. Red Wing. And they're able to save the Hispanic kid that kind of got them all started on the mission, and Cap has fleas. And then we figure out who is funding Malice and the whole immigration thing that this all started off with, and it was the Serpent Solutions. Marvel's universe is just as crazy, wacky, and weird as DC's. I'm just more familiar with DC's, so I have no idea who the fuck these guys are. But though, to be fair, they kind of do acknowledge just how obscure these guys are going to be, as they're getting ready to introduce, like, or they're leading up to their introduction, and they go, who is it then? Hydra? We already took care of them, remember? AIM? Actually, they're good guys now, or something. Who then? And that's how we get to this, the Serpent Solutions. There's more in between it, but yeah, it's just whatever. Really fun book. I was hoping for more of the political stuff. You know, as we move closer to this presidential election and stuff, the political stuff and satire and commentary, I'm going to find more interesting than fun, wacky comic bookness. That being said, after two issues where it's very prominent, I can understand wanting to, you know, just let off the gas a little bit. So I've never read much Marvel. They've never really been my characters. I picked this up because it looked interesting, and I ended up being really happy with it. And it's been added to my poll and everything. I don't know if I mentioned that. But yeah, Marvel, by and large, there's nothing wrong with them, of course. They're just not my characters, not my universe. And there are various reasons behind that. I find a lot of Marvel's stuff is, or Marvel heroes are predicated on making mistakes, and that's how villains in that universe tend to succeed, is because the hero did something wrong, or the hero fell short, so the villain was able to achieve more. And I just don't have much patience for that kind of writing. And I don't feel like that's incredibly problematic all the time, but it just gets old to me really quickly, and I know a lot of characters are kind of predicated on that. you know, they want the characters to be relatable, people make mistakes. So I've never really read much Marvel is what I'm getting at here. And so, I have no idea what the fuck Cap Wolf is. I'm sure it's a thing, don't get me wrong. They're clearly referencing something here, and they even kind of vaguely mention the continuity of it, which is weird since they just rebooted continuity, kind of, sort of. What's up with all the soft reboots? Just do a full reboot, come on. Yeah, so they kind of sort of rebooted continuity, and so I don't know why you'd keep all that stuff, but whatever, it's their universe, they do what they want with it. And it was fun. It's certainly fun. I think I would enjoy this issue more if I'd been reading Captain America for years and now I got to see Sam Wilson be Cap Wolf. That being said, though, there is one amazing panel. This book's doing a lot of time jumps, too. Hey, is that Captain... Or, so he's like... He's Cap Wolf, but he's still using the Falcon wings. And he's flying through the streets of New York. And a guy goes, hey, is that Captain America? He's a werewolf now? A flying werewolf? And then someone else, a flying werewolf and a communist? I liked him before, but that's too far. So I think they might be picking up on the fact that this is pretty damn silly. I don't know. I would have enjoyed it more, I imagine, if I was more into older Captain America comics. But they gotta... I suppose they do have to do something for that group that are reading this because they're big Captain America fans and they've been reading anything with Captain America on it for years. So there's nothing wrong with that, certainly. And it is fun, not gonna lie. I just hope it gets back to the roots of what they started out doing kind of soon here. So, go ahead and move on to the last book this week, which is Action Comics number 46, Corruption. I enjoyed this a lot more than I had been. The idea of Superman having something in his head that's making him just feel nothing but anger, and him being able to control that and use it and utilize it. There we go. There's the word I want. Him being able to utilize that and do constructive things with it and try to use it against his enemy. That was really clever. Also, just with the weaker Superman thing right now, he's dealing with issues that he hasn't had to before, which is really interesting. Again, really Halloween-y feel here. Because, like, they get to this base and there's Wrath doing all this evil stuff. And she's planning to, like, take over the world with this black goop shit. And then, like, the big reveal for the issue, I guess, is who she's using to, like, you know, lead her troops, as it were. And it's Frankenstein. So again, a bit of a Halloween-y feel. And so Superman and Frankenstein are fighting, and there's the Lee girl that Superman's been hanging out with. Who's trying to convince him to, you know, hold back a little bit, because otherwise, you know, he'll be under Wrath's control. And Wrath has this great little line at the end. I thought he was like you. He is. He's the best man I've ever known, Lee. Just look at him. I don't create that kind of fury. I just uncover what's already there. This is why I've done what I've done, and this is why you'll help me. So that people like us can stop monsters like them. And so we have Superman and Frankenstein fighting, and that's going to be the next issue. No, but overall, I did like this more. The idea that rage and wrath and, you know, essentially evil is a corruptive force, and it doesn't... I guess that's kind of been set up since the beginning of this whole thing, ever since I jumped on the book, is... evil isn't alien. Evil is inherent. I find that really fascinating. There's that quote, how does it go? The only thing that is needed for evil men to do evil things is for good men to do nothing. Something to that effect. It's an old quote you hear a lot talked about with the Holocaust. And I certainly, to one extent or another, agree with that sentiment. But I find this possibly more accurate. The idea that evil, fury, rage, wrath, is infectious, and it's already there. It just needs to be brought out. It's probably why I find the Joker to be such an interesting character, is he's always, or often portrayed as obsessed with making people reveal how ugly they are inside. And to do that with Superman, to have Superman, you know, stripped of everything that makes him Superman, and then forced to, you know, get down and dirty with all the pain and difficulty of not being perfect, and to be pushed to the edge in every conceivable way, and still try to be Superman, is really fascinating. And so that's what the cliffhanger of this issue is all about, is Superman still Superman when you take everything away from him? Or is he just another monster? Is he some kind of horrible Frankenstein or whatever? And I guess that's where the story is going. And I mean, it's... I guess I'm just now realizing, but it has been there since the beginning, because in that first issue, you know, you had the whole police protest thing, and then the over-aggressive cops, and you had the chief or captain or whatever sitting there talking to Superman, telling him that, you know, he's tired of cleaning up all Superman's messes, basically. And how he's been waiting for an excuse to do this, and how he's gonna, you know, beat the shit out of every single person there, including Superman, and yada yada yada. And that's when Superman snaps and punches the guy harder than he ever should punch what he thinks is a person. And it's revealed that the guy's actually one of these shadow monster things. But the point Superman makes in that issue is, I got lucky, and so did the cops. Because the cops were following his orders, but they were very much in, just as far into everything that he was ordering them to do as he was. They were being told to attack peaceful demonstrators while they were wearing riot gear, and they were doing it. And then once it was revealed that he's some kind of evil outside alien thing, yeah, they stop, they realize the error of their ways, whatever, and it gives them an excuse for what they did. But again, that's the thing. Evil is inherent, and it's always just there waiting to be brought out. And I find that really interesting, and I'm curious to see what Pack is going to do with that and with Superman. Because, I mean, this is always the problem with the Superman story. With Batman, it's highly unlikely anyone will ever have Batman decide to kill a person when they set him up in a situation or whatever, where that seems like his only option. But it's always vaguely there. You can always believe that Batman will go too far and do that. Superman, on the other hand, it's harder to get invested in the drama of whether or not he will do that. Like, right now, I imagine if I were a really big Superman fan, I could conceivably be mad at this for setting Superman up to be anything but a good guy. To be anything but in complete and total control. But because I have more of an outsider perspective on Superman, because he's not my character, but because I know a lot about him, I can easily see that, you know, the writer's going to push Superman to his limits and then stop and make sure that he remains Superman. Or goes back to being Superman or something. I'm not quite buying the drama, is I guess what my biggest complaint would be. And that's not really the fault of the book. The book is doing everything it can. And I mean, it's literally infecting Superman and making him feel rage, an emotion that he's not accustomed to. I think he's doing the best job he can to set up the drama, but I don't know if I can buy that he's gonna go, that Superman's actually gonna go over the line, even though he's being pushed to his limits. Yeah. Good book, though. I mean, obviously, I really enjoyed it, obviously. I wish I'd started reading, like, as collected, issue 42 to 46, and, you know, however long the story arc's gonna last. That, it probably would have been a bit better if I was reading this all collected. Because right now it's just okay. Alright, right now I'm kind of on-off. I mean, I'm, like, some weeks I'm really liking it, some weeks I'm not quite caring for it, or I just think it's okay, or I'm disappointed, what have you. This, since issue 42, this is the first issue that I've really, really enjoyed. The other issues are good to okay or whatever, but this is the first issue that I'm actively enjoying again. So yeah. Let's go ahead and go on to the first trade this week, which, really short, kind of hard to even call it a trade. It's more of just a single issue, a one-shot, if you will. JLA versus Predators. So here's a goofy idea for a comic, right? I mean, comics are always kind of goofy, kind of weird, whatever. But the entire Justice League versus Predator, that's hard to buy. The Justice League is, you know, a galactic-level power. They can take care of galactic-level threats, and they have multiple times. So a Predator, like, you can set Superman up against Predator, you can set Batman up against Predator on their own, isolated, and I can buy it. But the entire league, that's hard to buy. That is hard to swallow, you gotta admit. I got this with the Green Lantern versus Alien book I talked about last time. So yeah, that is certainly hard to swallow. That being said, if you're willing to accept goofy comic book logic, and I don't mean that as a bad thing, just if you're willing to accept, oh, well, technology is capable of whatever the writer wants it to be capable of. Alien technology is a get-out-of-jail-free card comic book logic. What they do kind of makes sense. A little bit. So, I mean, it is a basic Predator story. All the League members are being kind of, you know, hunted down one by one by Predators, or in groups, I guess. This is a really good panel. And then it's followed up by that, which just Kyle throwing up into a Green Lantern construct. So yeah, this is a really wacky idea for a premise. How do I explain it? So they're not normal predators, obviously. These predators have been enhanced by alien technology, or genetically bred by alien technology, to mimic the powers of the Justice League in order to be able to defeat them. And they've been enhanced by the Dominion, which is not the Star Trek series that I've been... not the villain from Star Trek, but another alien species. These are the Dominion, and this is how they've... this is how they've genetically engineered the predators so that it can, you know, do what Plastic Man does and turn into vehicles, and there's another predator that can swim as fast as Aquaman, and there's one that can go toe-to-toe with Wonder Woman, and one that can go toe-to-toe with Superman, and one that can deal with Green Lantern, and one that can deal with the Atom, and yada yada yada. So the predators were engineered as weapons to be able to attack and take down the Justice League, but they kind of turned on their creators, yada yada yada. And eventually, the Justice League defeats them by doing the old switching dance partners routine. And so each of the members takes on a different predator than the one that was designed for them, and they're able to defeat them that way. So it is really typical. I mean, it's got to be 90s, right? 595 is how much this book costs. That's pretty good. Early 2000s, which is basically still the 90s. 2000s comics doesn't really come around until 2004 or 2005. So anyway, we have them all defeat the predators, and so it's a pretty typical plot. That being said, there are some parts to this that I really do like. Like, even though they're, you know, not proper predators and stuff, there are some lines in this where they still act like predators, which is, you know, to just generally be kind of dicks. So, like, they're all talking about a plan to take down the predators, and then Superman goes, wait, they're already here. I can see them. And so the predators decloak, and the predators decloak, and one, like, plays a little audio recording. Come where you are to hunt, to kill, which is something someone said earlier. So, like, the predators are here to, of course, attack them, and that's how we get a big brawl where they all start switching partners. But no, there's a lot of stuff like that where it's like, they're still kind of predatory. That sounds bad. So, overall, I guess this... if you're a really big Predator fan, or just the wackiness of it does make you want to read it, go ahead. But if you only like Predator when it's good, nah. This isn't good. This is something to read if you just really, really want to. It could have been done significantly better. If you had a predator manipulate the league into becoming weaker, somehow found a way to slowly drain Green Lantern's ring, neutralized some of the powers of the different leaguers, stuff like that, And you had one actual predator slowly bring them all down, it probably would have been a lot better, more understated book. But I doubt you could do that all in one issue. This gets a lot done in one kind of long issue. I don't know. It's goofy. It's certainly goofy 90s-ness. I mean, it's still got the 90s Justice League, so that tells you a lot. Meh. I enjoyed it. I'm not going to lie. I did enjoy it for what it is. So take that how you will. So worth your time to pick up. Like I said, if you're a really big Predator fan, you must get your hands on everything Predator. Of course. If you really like kind of, you know, kooky comic book crossovers, sure, why not? But if you want something good, Green Lantern Aliens wasn't great, but it was better than this. So, yeah. Green Lantern Predator would be a lot better, though. I want a Green Lantern Predator crossover. Okay. Let's wrap up this week with the trade of Princess Leia. This was a mini-series that was coming out last year in the whole Marvel Star Wars book line. And Princess Leia got her own miniseries, basically, and this is the collected version of that. What's the premise behind it? Well, in Star Wars Episode 4, the Death Star blows up Alderaan, which is Princess Leia's home planet, and now she's in the rebellion still and all that stuff. But the Empire is now hunting down survivors of Alderaan, people from Alderaan who were on other planets at the time and stuff like that. So that actually makes sense. And because they fear that they'll go join the Resistance since their home planet just got blown up, which makes me question the usefulness of the Death Star if you're just going to go around blowing up planets with it and that was supposed to keep the galaxy in check via fear. Well, anytime you blow up any planet in such a widely diverse universe in which there are, you know, large populations of different species on planets halfway across the galaxy, well, couldn't you just, like, wouldn't you just be creating enemies every time you're doing it? You're just fueling the rebellion every time you use the Death Star. Anyway, well, I guess the point is that you're not supposed to have to use the Death Star. So yeah, you got the whole premise of that's what the Empire's game is, and Leia's game is that she needs to go in and save all of them because she's the last royal, she's the last Princess of Alderaan. That's a good name for a Princess Leia book. That's what this should be called, not Star Wars Princess Leia, Star Wars The Last Princess of Alderaan. That's a fantastic title. Excuse me while I go call Marvel and give them a better title for the, when they eventually reprint this book. Anyway. So the premise certainly makes sense. The problem is it's not very good. Leia's got a bodyguard, and, you know, people of Alderaan think she's stuck up or that she doesn't really care about her family and their people that have all died, that she just cares about the rebellion. And that stuff I don't find particularly interesting. And there's this issue of the fact that she hasn't grieved properly for her family or for her people. And they never really go anywhere with that. She says that she doesn't have time to grieve, that she has to, that grieving isn't productive, that she has to be protecting her people right now. And maybe they did something with that in the main Star Wars book. I haven't been reading that. But this just, it's not particularly good. I didn't really get invested in this book until the last issue. And it's just one speech in the last issue. So like I said, they don't really go anywhere with her, you know, not grieving. She ends up, you know, getting... through her quest, the people of Alderaan surviving hear about it, and then all decide kind of independently to come together because of it. And then, like, they're about to be attacked by a Imperial fleet. And so this is probably the best scene in the entire book. Hold on, let me find it. Sorry. Okay, here we go. To every Alderaanian within the sound of my voice, this is Princess Leia Organa. To the newcomers, I would ordinarily be very grateful that you responded to our call for unity, but as things stand today, I wish you hadn't come. An Imperial Star Destroyer is heading in this direction and will reach us within minutes. There is no time to escape by standard lanes, no time to attain hyperspace. It wants to kill the last Alderaanians. And without the Asperian fleet on our side, I'm afraid it has enough firepower to do the job. But we will not surrender. We will defend ourselves, but we won't land one more blow than necessary. We are not our enemy. We are Alderaan. We answer rage with wisdom. We answer fear with imagination. We answer war with hope. If one life with a single drop of Alderaanian blood survives, Alderaan survives. If one life with a passion for Alderaanian creativity survives, Alderaan survives. And we are, each of us, important. And whatever happens, I bow to all of you and to our future. And that speech... Excuse me. And that speech inspires the people to fight, and, you know, there's this whole thing about kind of a mixed race living on a planet that kind of cut ties with Alderaan a long time ago. That inspires them to help in the battle and take down the Star Destroyer so that Alderaan can live on. Damn good speech. Not a very good book. It's kind of all over the place. Like, they're trying to... There's a lot of spy shit going on in the Star Wars canon right now. Darth Vader's all spy-y, and so is the Lando book that was all heist spy-ish kind of stuff, and now this is all spy-ish. Is just this all a big Shadow Ops book or universe. So this was, like, there's a lot of spy stuff going on in it that just, it's not nearly as good as the other spy stuff going on in the other books, so it has that to deal with. And it's just kind of directionless. The premise is Leia's going to save Alderaan. She goes and just randomly is gathering people from Alderaan. And you think that there's going to be this whole thing about how she needs to grieve, she needs to take time for herself, she needs to not just be a princess and warrior and a rebel leader, but also to be a human being. Or an Alderaanian, I guess? I don't know. But they don't really give her that time. It's not like after she unites Alderaan under one flag, she unites all the survivors, she goes into the back room and starts crying for her father or anything like that, or for her people. She just kind of goes off and is like, okay, I'm going back to the normal Star Wars book now. Bye. That's pretty much it. So I was kind of disappointed by that. I thought it was kind of silly. You know, maybe that would have contradicted the point, but I don't see why you keep bringing it up if it's not the point. You know, the idea of, oh, well, she's a strong female character, she's a true leader and all that stuff. Yeah, that's fair, and that should certainly be her public face, but there's an old quote from one of the Roman senators, about the philosophy of Stoicism. So Stoicism was this idea that, you know, essentially Vulcanism, that you should never really let emotions guide you in any way, that you should not be a slave to your emotions, that you should only let logic and reason dictate your actions. And one of the Roman senators who was kind of known as a Stoic said, "That's all true, but we are not statues." And what the intent behind that idea is, you know, reason and logic should be used in making your decisions and planning in your life and all that stuff. But that doesn't mean you're not allowed to grieve. You're not allowed to feel joy. You can still be a Stoic and have emotions. You're just not supposed to let them affect your decision-making. And that's an interesting idea. And so I guess I would have preferred them to do something like that, where, you know, she doesn't have time to grieve. She has to save her people. Well, she saved her people. Now she should have a little time to fucking grieve. I don't know. Maybe I'm missing the point of the book. If you read it and enjoyed it, please leave it in the comments below. If you feel like I've misguided in my assumptions or my analysis of the book, but I just really did not enjoy this one. It's bad. I hate to say it, but it is bad. Normally I'll stop it. It's just not good. No, it's actually kind of bad. Because it sets up a lot of things and it doesn't really go anywhere. Like, her whole mission in this is to unite the people of Alderaan. But she doesn't truly do that. It just kind of happens on its own. You know, she puts out the call and lets people know she's serious about it, but she just kind of sets it up and walks away. She doesn't actively go and recruit every Alderaanian. She doesn't actively do much except save a band and, you know, one girl. And then there's, I don't know, it's all over the place. The people of Alderaan come together in the end, but it's not because of her. She puts the word out, but that's about it. And then she just kind of fucks off at the end of this, which makes it actively worse. She gives this great big speech about how, you know, oh, we're gonna fight, we're gonna be Alderaan, Alderaan will survive, basically. And then it just kind of, she's like, peace. I didn't much care for it. Kind of a bad book. And that's disappointing, because, I mean, it's Princess Leia. It could have been really cool. Any little girl who grew up idolizing Princess Leia won't be disappointed, and Star Wars fans are in for a real treat. GeekedOutNation.com. No, you're really not. It's not particularly good. Sorry. Mark Wade? Really? Mark Wade? What were you doing, Mark Wade? Give me Gail Simone on a Princess Leia book any day. But that'll do it for this week's episode of Comic Reviews. Sorry to leave it on such a sour note. It was a pretty good week overall. This is a nice turnaround from last week. You know, all my single issues were good. My trades, not so much. It's usually quite the opposite. Anyway. If you have a suggestion for a single issue book that's coming out month to month you would like me to pick up and hear my thoughts on, please leave it in the comments below. or if you think or if you could think of a trade that you'd like to hear me talk about, trade, graphic novel, what have you, please leave that in the comments below, and I'll put it on my list of things to get a hold of, but I can't promise how soon I'll get to it. It's just a matter of when I can find it. Though I do write everything down, I want you to know that. Anyway, everyone, thank you very much for watching. Until next time, I'm Sid Part 2. Bye.